friend and I actually went to South Carolina to a similar concept. And the owners of that concept, basically, we went after the class. We were like, we want to bring this back to Raleigh. And they said no. And I looked at my friend. I was like, no one tells me no. So what no taught me was, you know, you really have to dig deep and find, you know, what your mission is to whatever you want to do. And in the franchise world, it's just a different beast. And having a concept like a paint and sip concept where it's, you know, it's kind of a different concept. It's not a food business. A lot of people did. And they didn't believe in you, and having no was, you know, was something that was told to me or in my team a lot. And, you know, we had to dig deep and figure out how to, you know, make people believe in it. And we did. And that's why I think we have accomplished having, you know, 80 plus studios nationwide. You have to take upon yourself to learn business as a lawyer, business as a marketer, business, you know, when you own your own business or start a franchise, you have to learn all that stuff and really can't, I'm not saying you can't trust people because you always have to trust people, but you really do have to watch your back. When I started the business, I wasn't trying to franchise it. It was more of a business where I could, you know, stay at home and be with my kids as well as work and use my brain as well. So whenever we started the franchise process about 9 months later, we kind of did it all backwards, and we trust in attorneys and stuff like that, which I would not do that now. I would kind of do my homework first before I would talk to an attorney. If you do want to start a franchise concept, that first store or your first business that you want to make, the flagship store, you need to have kick ass, excuse my French, revenue, because that is what sells your franchise, is people to know that you can actually make money off of it. I will say that I had an ex business partner, the one that I went to, the one that we created the business together, and we actually didn't sign an operating agreement, and which it has caused major problems in that last 5 years. And when I went on Shark Tank and got a deal from Kevin O'Leary, she had to be the one that signs on for him to be as a partner. And when she said no, that was so devastating and heartbroken that, you know, I'm still picking myself off the floor from it. You know, when that happened, it really made me understand that, you know, this has got to be my own, and I don't need to have somebody pulling the company down. I really talked to a lot of entrepreneurs about franchising, and I have partners come in and I'm like, I don't want to talk to you unless you have an agreement, because if you don't have an agreement, you guys aren't going to work out. And it's very true. Like, if you don't have a strong agreement, operating agreement with a partner, either A, your business is going to fail, B, you're going to lose friendships, C, it's just going to be awful. You're going to go in lawsuits and stuff like that. So that's my number one thing. And that's one thing I've learned about this business. And granted, you know, it happened. There's a lot of people I don't know that have been partners and have not gone through a bad partnership one time in their life. Spend the money on contracts and have everything in writing. If you're talking to a PR agency and y'all agree verbally, you follow up with an email and say, hey, this was great to talk with you. This is what we talked about. And have it in writing, because everything that you have in writing is documented. Nothing that is not in writing, you will not have documented, and you cannot have proof if something goes wrong. So, yep. And that is what I've learned. You know, when I first started this business, I was at old school. I wish we could just shake hands, be friends, and da-da-da. And that just doesn't happen these days. Like, you have to, with social media and everything else, you have to have everything in writing. And that's my number one thing and lesson learned in this business, is everything in writing and following up. Balance is so key, and I can't stress enough to women, because I really do think, and I say this to my husband all the time, I do think it's, as a woman CEO working full-time, is a lot more stress on her shoulders to come home, to try to fix a meal, to be a mom, to read the books, more than a male, because that's just kind of, they've always done that, you know, right. In the old ages, that's what they did. And now the women are picking up kind of what the men do, plus what they did back in the day, stay at home, you know? And I think it's really encouraging to women that it can be done. We just want to make sure it's a good environment for everybody. And just like potential franchisees, you know, we have to say no to them. You know, if they don't have, they don't know anything about the internet, or they don't know how to do social media, or if they're saying that, you know, they have a full-time job, but they also want to own a franchise, we have to say, well, it's not the right fit for you. You know, this is a full-time job and you have to commit it. So, you know, saying no to potential franchisees that are willing to give you a franchise fee and stuff like that is hard, but it's best for, you know, your company.